Okay, I think we are live. So welcome everybody to this Latin American webinar on physics. This new, our webinar number 89, sorry. So we are just one more to arrive to the 90th webinar. So today we have a very interesting talk. The speaker is Silvia Manconi from the Institute of Theoretical Particle Physics and Cosmology from the University, from the RWTH Aachen in Germany. Or the Rheinische Westfalische Technische Hochschule Aachen. Perfect. So Silvia, she obtained the PhD from the Università degli Studi di Torino and INFN Torino. And now she's a postdoc there in the RWTH in Aachen. So she's working on various topics on theoretical astroparticle physics. And she just got the PhD last year. And she's from Sardinia, from where she did the bachelor studies in physics in the University of Cagliari. So the talk of Silvia's, the title of Silvia's talk is Insight on the Local Emission of Cosmic Rays, Electron and Positron. So Silvia, welcome to the Latin American webinar on physics. And
thank you. Yes, thank you. Okay, so I will stop the video and share my screen. Exactly. Right, can you see the slides right now?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so thank you very much for the introduction and for this nice opportunity. I will talk about some recent work we did in collaboration with Mattia Di Mauro and Fiorenza Donato about insights we can have on the local emission of cosmic ray electrons and positrons. This is an overview of the talk. I will start with an introduction and then I will speak about some multi-messenger constraints to the local emission of cosmic ray electrons and positrons. We were studying using the radio emission from supernova remnants or the emission in gamma rays from nearby pulsar nebula. And then I will summarize. Let's start with the introduction. I like to show to you the total flux of cosmic rays we receive at the Earth to see where the electrons and positrons to which we will concentrate in this talk are related to the rest of the cosmic rays. So you see here the total cosmic ray flux, and this is the flux multiplied normally to the second power of the energy as a function of the energy we detect at the Earth. And you see that the component we are talking about is just a few percent of the total cosmic ray flux. Here you see the electrons and positrons, and here the total electrons plus positron flux that is dominated by the electron component. Those particles, even if they are subdominant in the cosmic ray total flux, they are a unique window to the acceleration of particles to the multi-TV energies and to the properties of the local galactic environment. In fact, as we will see later on, those particles, since suffer the severe radiative losses, have a typical propagation scale of few kiloparsecs, so they test the properties of local sources of cosmic rays. This is a view of the present situation of the observation for the total flux of electrons plus positrons, the positron flux, the positron fraction, and the electron component. So you see that all those fluxes, they have different spectral characteristics, and those are a result of different mechanisms and source classes we want to investigate. In particular, in the last 10 years, I would say the positron flux or the positron fraction has gained a lot of attention since we observe what we call a rise in the positron fraction. So the flux that is observed above about 10 GeV, here you see again this flux as a function of the energy, is exceeding what we call the predicted secondary component. So what we expect for the antimatter production from the spallation of primary cosmic ray, hadronic cosmic rays into the interstellar medium. So in order to explain these rays, and then recently the AMS experiment reported also a sharp fall above about 300 GeV, we need a new primary source of cosmic ray positrons, so antimatter cosmic rays, in addition to the secondaries, in order to explain those data. So if we want to understand and model those fluxes, what are the ingredients we need to care about? We have different components in this modeling. First of all, we need to understand what are the cosmic ray sources. And in particular, we need to understand what is the acceleration mechanism, what is the source distribution in the galaxy, and what is the source spectrum that is produced from each sources. Then, no matter what is the cosmic ray source, Those particles propagate in the galaxy, and in order to understand this process, we need to understand different inputs, in particular some astrophysics input, such as, for example, the value of the magnetic field, the value of the diffusion coefficient, and what is the matter and photon distribution in our galaxy. But we need also some basic physics input, as, for example, we need to understand what are the cross-sections of interaction of those particles with the interstellar medium or the electromagnetic energy losses. Once we model those two steps, then we are ready to compute what we call the propagated spectrum and to compare with the fluxes that we just seen that are detected by different experiments on satellites, for example. So all this problem can be seen as a propagation equation in which we have a source there, in which we put all the information of the production of cosmic rays. Then we have a propagation operator that will have inside all the processes that happen during the propagation. And our goal is to solve this problem to obtain the flux at the Earth. This is a view of the galaxy as is seen for a cosmic ray physicist. So for us, the galaxy is very well approximated by a cylinder in which the magnetic field are confined. Here you see this ticked cylinder in which here there is the galactic center. We are here at 8 kiloparsecs from the center, and the total radius of this cylinder is about 20 kiloparsecs. So here you see a thin cylinder instead, that is the disk in which the gas and the stars and all the sources of cosmic rays are confined. Instead, here you see the part in which the galactic magnetic field are confined. In this diffusion zone, different processes are going on, but if we want to analyze the electrons and positrons at energy larger than 10 GeV, we need to care in particular about energy losses by synchrotron emission in the galactic magnetic field and inverse Compton scattering on the different interstellar radiation fields. And then we need to care about the fact that the random scattering in the magnetic field irregularities is causing spatial diffusion on those charged particles. The solar modulation for us is subdominant in this energy range, and this effect is coming from the solar wind that is depleting the total flux of the interstellar flux before those particles will reach our detectors. So the propagation equation can be written in this way for electrons and positrons, in which you see the diffusion term and the energy loss term. So as for the diffusion, in principle, you can model it in a very complicated way, taking into account the parallel and perpendicular component of this diffusion coefficient. But for our purposes, we will consider it as isotropic, even if we will see in the following results that we have evidences that actually this diffusion coefficient is not isotropic, at least nearby the sources. And here you see the energy loss term, in which we have the synchrotron term, as I was saying before, and then the different photon fields that we need in order to compute the inverse Compton losses. We solve, and I will discuss with you some results obtained solving this equation with semi-analytical methods, in which we take into account both the vertical and radial border normally, but there are on the market also very different numerical codes that solve numerically this problem, taking into account also, for example, the spatial distribution of the energy losses. But for our purposes, this is not making a lot of difference, because in any case, the typical propagation scale for those particles is pretty small. And this is demonstrated by this quantity that is the typical propagation scale, this lambda, that is the integral of the diffusion coefficient divided by the energy loss term. And I'm plotting this quantity here as a function of the energy that we detect at the Earth for different energy, starting energy at the source. And you see that, for example, if you concentrate on one cosmic ray electron that you received at 100 GeV, but was produced at the source at 1 TeV energies, you see that the typical propagation scale, so effectively the horizon of this particle is 4 kiloparsec. It's similarly for the same energies here. So since these, we need to take into account and to remind that those particles probe the few kiloparsecs near the Earth, and so it's very important to model the local sources of cosmic ray electrons and positrons. So what are the different candidates in order to produce electrons and positrons in our local galaxy? We have supernova remnants, that is a late stage of the evolution of massive stars in which a strong shock is propagating through the interstellar medium and possibly accelerated the matter that is meeting in this shock. Then we have the pulsar wind nebula that are believed to be accelerators of both electrons and positrons, since electrons and positron pairs are produced in the very strong magnetofield of these sources. And we will see later on some more details about those two types of sources. But if we want to look nearby the Earth, so now in this plot here, you see we are sitting in the center. This is the distance from us. And we are plotting here the position of the supernova remnant that are dots and the pulsar wind nebula that are stars that are found in the source catalog around us. So you see that we don't have a long list of candidates, and actually we will concentrate on those, in particular, those four sources of which I've wrote also the name. And in order to compute what is the flux of electrons and positrons we expect from these sources, we need to model, you remember, the source term from the propagation equation. And in this source term, we have different entries. In particular, we need to model the energy spectrum. We need to model the spatial distribution, but that for single sources is just we need to know the distance from these sources. And then there is also the possibility that this emission has a time dependency, so we need to learn about it. And our focus during the rest of the talk will be to use radio and gamma ray emission in order to get insights on the cosmic ray emission from those candidate local sources, and in particular about those four sources we see here. So let's keep going with the rest of the talk, in which I will show to you some recent results. And let's start from local supernova remnant and radio constraints. So supernova remnant in general are believed to be the main sources of galactic cosmic rays, both protons and electrons in particular. And we have different evidences for the fact that the cosmic rays are accelerating in this system. In particular, we see a pion bump, so the evidence that there are protons accelerating around the sources in gamma rays, but we see also the sources in radio emission and X-ray emission. So we have the evidence that there are high energy electrons accelerating around. The injection spectrum is general model as a power law. Here we have a normalization, and we believe that at some point this acceleration mechanism will have an exponential cutoff. And as I was saying before, we have very few observed supernova remnants and can contribute significantly to the observed flux by just looking to the distance and the age of the sources that we have in the catalogs. And from now on, we will concentrate on the two sources we have at distances that are less than 0.5 kiloparsecs. So in this work, we wanted to use the radio emission in order to constrain more the parameters for the source term, in order to compute more carefully the contribution from those two sources. And in particular, we decided to analyze the full radio emission that is seen from these two sources and to fit this full radio spectrum in order to find regions in the parameter space for the source term. This is translated into the result that you see in the left plot here, in which you see some contours for the total energy that is connected to the normalization of the spectrum and the spectral index. And to relate the radio spectrum to those two parameters, we use this formula in which you see also the distance and the magnetic field appears. So you see here that those two different bubbles have different contours. They are 1, 2, and 3 sigma contours from the fit to the radio data. Here for the Vela supernova remnant, and here for the Cygnus loop. You see that if we want to constrain the source term using those radio data, we find very narrow ranges for the injection spectrum. Now, if we let vary the normalization and the spectral index only in those regions, and in particular, we concentrate on the two sigma regions that are allowed by looking to the radio emission, we end up with those propagation spectrum bands. So you see that now the contribution from Vela and Cygnus loop is bounded in those two regions. And depending on the particular 1, 2, 3 sigma that you consider here, I'm considering 2 sigma, the flux from those two sources can reach the flux data that we have additive energies. This is the total electron plus positron spectrum, but as we saw before, this is dominated by the electron component. We went forward in that because, in principle, the radio emission that we see in supernova remnants is from low-energy particles that are still trapped in the supernova remnant. But the particles that we are more interested in, actually, are the ones that escaped already the system and they are traveling towards the Earth. So we include these, we try to include these in this model by looking to modeling that were available in the literature for the escape of electrons from supernova remnant. So now the quantities that will be fixed to radio data are only the normalization of the trapped electrons, and then we compute the normalization and spectral index of the escaped electron through the models that we found in the literature. So now we have two different sets of contours. Here again, the one for the trapped cosmic rays, and here the one that we can compute, taking into account the modeling for the escape of those electrons. You see that apart from the difference in normalization, because we have to divide somehow those particles between the one that are still trapped and the one that are that has been released, we have also a general shift in the spectral index that is expected to be connected with the escape mechanism. Now, if we play the same game to compute what is the expected contribution of those two sources to the electrons plus positron flux, we see that the band is a little bit lower, and in particular, there is a depletion of the cosmic ray flux at low energies with respect to the plot that I was showing to you before. And this is the effect of the fact that those particles in this model are now trapped in the system, and they have not escaped yet. So this is showing to us the importance of modeling the escape of electrons from nearby supernova remnant in order to understand their contribution to the GV and TV energies, and more work has to be done in order to understand those processes in the future. But imagine that we want to consider if we can fit all the electrons plus positron spectrum by looking to the constraints of those nearby supernova remnants, and by taking into account all the different other components that I didn't commented before in the introduction. We demonstrated in this paper that actually we are able to reproduce the total electron plus positron flux with a nice chi-square. And here I want just to comment a little bit on the other components that I'm not mentioning in the rest of the talk. Here you have the secondary emission that is in any case subdominant in all the range from the spallation of the cosmic ray protons and other hadronic cosmic rays into the interstellar medium. Then we have the contribution from far away supernova remnant, the contribution from nearby supernova remnant that here is bounded from the radio data that we saw before, and then the total contribution from the pulsar wind nebula that we have in the catalog. If we can then also check if the dipole anisotropy from those nearby sources is compatible or not with the upper limits, the answer is yes. And here I'm just plotting the comparison between the upper limits that have been released from the Fermi-LAT experiment with respect to the expectation that we have in this particular model. I'm not going to discuss more into the details these dipole anisotropies. What we need to understand for this plot is just that we measure not only the cosmic ray flux, but we measure also the arrival direction of those charged particles at very high energies. If we have a very bright dominant source, we could expect that there is a dipole anisotropy in the observed flux. For electrons and positrons, we don't see this in the experiment. So we have upper limits that are those values as a function of the energy. So we need to take into account also the fact if we want to produce a model that is compatible with all the observables. And I inserted some more backup slides on this topic if you are interested. So this is just to demonstrate that it's possible to build a model that is compatible both with the data of electrons and positrons, both in flux and dipole anisotropy, but also with the multi-wavelength observation of few local sources. Now let's move on to the other sources we want to discuss and that will we will discuss for the rest of the talk that are pulsars and the pulsar wind nebula. So the engine of those sources is the central pulsar, that is a fast rotating magnetized neutron star. That is the final stage of the evolution of a very massive star. In the high magnetic field, a wind of particles is extracted from the surface of the pulsars, and electrons and positron pairs are produced in the electromagnetic cascade. And this is a way of producing not only electrons, so matter, but also antimatter particles, and in particular, positrons. In this way, the pulsar spin their energy is transferred to electrons and positron pairs that are then accelerated to very high energies. And also in this case, we expected that the acceleration is ending up producing a power law, but in principle with a different spectral index. After a few kilo years, those electrons and positron pairs are possible released in the interstellar medium, and they can reach our detectors and participate to the total electrons and positron flux we observe. And the relativistic electrons and positron pairs have been seen shining from radio to gamma rays. So we have a confirmation about the fact that this picture can make sense. And again, in order to compute what is the flux that we observe at the Earth, we need to understand different parameters from these sources. And this, in this case, we need to know what is the conversion efficiency of those systems for the pulsar spin down energy that is transferred into electrons and positron pairs. And also, as before, we need to know what is the spectral index of the electrons and positron distribution. So as I was saying, those electrons and positron pairs that have been accelerated, they lose energy by inverse Compton scattering and synchrotron emission, and they produce a cascade of photons in a broad range of frequency. So the idea is that with modeling the intensity and the distribution of the photon emission, we can learn about the properties of the accelerated electrons and positrons. And this is a method that is traditionally applied to the pulsar and to the pulsar wind nebula emission, but to the arcominute, arcosecond scale emission that is seen. And this is connected to physical distances from the central pulsar that is at most 1 parsec. What we will discuss later on is some emission that is extended few degree scale, so possibly physically tens of parsec away from the source. And those are the emission that have been seen by Oak and then recently also by Fermi-LAT data. Those two pulsars, Gaming and Monogy, will be protagonists for the rest of few slides. And they are among the most studied nearby pulsar because they are nearby and that they have been considered as the main candidate in order to produce the positron flux, this positron excess that we want to interpret. We have different scales of the emission from those sources. We have a pulsar that is point-like. We have then what we call the pulsar wind nebula that is seen both in X-ray and in radio. At the arcominute and arcosecond scale, you see here the radio emission and here the X-ray from Chandra, in particular for the Gemmingham pulsar wind nebula. And for this source, you see that we have this very peculiar morphology that is produced by the fact that this source is running in the interstellar medium with a very large proper motion. And this has caused the consequence of creating this bow shock pulsar wind nebula. And as we will see, will create also consequences for the GV morphology. A couple of years ago, in particular, 2 years ago, almost three, the Oak experiment detected and reported a few degree extended gamma ray emission from those two sources, Gemmingham and Monogen, at energy larger than 5 dB. And the Milagro experiment observed similar extended emission at a larger energy. And this is the scale of the emission. So here you see the moon to scale, and here is what the Oak experiment is seeing around those two nearby pulsars. So it's a few degree extended emission that is corresponding to 20 parsec. And remember that those two sources are far away 250 parsec and 280 parsec. So this is a significant amount of their distance with respect to us. So this has been recognized as the first evidence of electrons and positrons that are not more trapped and confined into the pulsar wind nebula, but are diffusing away from the pulsar, and they produce this inverse Compton emission by upscattering the CMB photons. So of course, we now believe that those electrons and positrons have been released into the interstellar medium, and they can probably participate to the flux of cosmic rays we see. So this is saying that we have a strong support for the idea that pulsar wind nebula can be indeed positron sources. So what we learn in particular from these OAK data? We learn the fact that we need a continuous injection of electrons and positrons in order to have a very high energy emission also after 300 kilo years after the death of this pulsar. Then we can compute what is the pulsar spindle energy that is converted into electrons and positrons, because we see the amount of energy that is lost in gamma rays, so we can compare with respect to what we expect from the pulsar spin-down energy, and we can compute the efficiency. And then one of the most striking results was the fact that if you analyze the profile of the gamma ray emission as a function of the distance from the central position of the source, you can compute how fast electrons and positrons diffuse away from the pulsar. And if you compute this number, you obtain a diffusion coefficient that is 500 times smaller with respect to the average value that we see in the galaxy by analyzing other sources and other cosmic rays. So this has been seen as the discovery about the fact that probably around in the vicinity and for a region that is at least 20 parsec, the properties of diffusion of cosmic ray electrons and positrons are different. But we want to use those multi-messenger data in order to predict the positron flux, that is from when we started. And here I want to stress to you that using photons between 5 and 40 TeV in order to predict what we are interested in, so the positrons where the positron excess is seen, is a strong extrapolation. In fact, if you use only the OAK results in order to calibrate the photon emission and here you see the spectral energy distribution of the inverse Compton emission, it's a function of the energy here, and the positron flux at the Earth, you understand that the Geminga contribution to the positron flux in particular is not constrained. And you can see here by looking to those two different lines with two different colors, they are both compatible with what we see in the OAK experiment here, but they end up with very different extrapolation in the Fermi-LAT energy range. And this has huge consequences for the contribution to the positron flux, because depending on the spectral index that for the blue is 2.3 and for the green is 2, we are compatible with the OAK data. And in fact, in the region, the very high energy region, those two contributions, they become again equal, but for the contribution to the positron flux in this range, they are pretty different. So we cannot conclude yet if this source can or not contribute significantly to the positron flux. So from this, the idea we had to analyze the Fermi-LAT data in this range in order to search for a counterpart of this gamma ray emission and possibly discriminate between the different spectral indexes for the accelerated positrons. So we analyzed the Fermi-LAT data in a very big region of interest, because if you saw before, the extension that is predicted at the very high energies, multi-TeV energies, at the GeV, the extension of this emission is predicted to increase even more. And we model this energy dependence of the spatial morphology of this inverse Compton emission by creating different templates for a large range of different diffusion coefficient. And then we test analyzing the data, which of the model was best at reproducing what we observe. And here you see what I was mentioning before, the fact that at low energies, and in particular, this is for 10 GeV, the morphology of the GeV emission coming from the inverse Compton scattering is expected to be distorted from the effect of the proper motion. And this effect is less important if you go to higher and higher energies. So we analyzed the Fermi-LAT data, and we found a detection for the Geminga halo in the Fermi-LAT data. And this detection is pretty significant. And depending on the background emission modeling, we have a diffusion coefficient that is ranging between compatible value with respect to the OAK experiment. And the physical side of this emission is about 60 parsecs at 100 GeV. And now, so in this spectral energy distribution of the Geminga, emission, we have the OCK measurement, and here we have the contribution that we are adding to the problem by adding the Fermi-LAT data. Those are detection and those are upper limits. So now you see that we can bound more the contribution of this source and the spectral energy distribution of this source. As for the monogen source, this is not significantly detected in the Fermi-LAT data, but we found upper limit for this emission. The fact that the proper motion is distorting the morphology of this emission has been also taken into account. And we found that actually by analyzing the data with a model in which the proper motion was included, the data were best fit. So the model fit with a proper motion is preferred at least at 4 sigma. And what we are seeing here is possibly the first time that we are detecting the proper motion of a pulsar and pulsar with nebula only by looking to GeV gamma rays. That is a sort of first time in gamma ray astronomy. So now we want to compute what are the consequences of this observation for the interpretation of the cosmic positron flux. And in order to take into account this, now we update our diffusion model. In particular, we consider what we call a two-zone diffusion model, in which we put the slow diffusion just in the region in which we see the gamma rays. In this plot is called relic pulsar wind nebula. And here you see we have the gamma rays and the fast diffusion in the rest of the galaxy. This is in order to take into account both the evidence that we have from the gamma rays, but also the fact that for the rest of the galaxy, we don't have any other evidence for the fact that we have a slow diffusion also there. And so if you compute what is the contribution to the positron flux now by taking into account also this two-zone diffusion model for the Geminga pulsar and for the monogen pulsar, you end up with those contours by varying different parameters that are compatible with the gamma rays. So the conclusion is that the Geminga and monogen can contribute at most few percent to the AMS positrons data, and that alone those two sources, as constrained by now from OCK and Fermi-LAT data, they cannot contribute more than those few percent to the positron excess. So now we are left with a different question. First of all, is this gamma ray halo that we are seeing both in Geminga and then in OCK experiment also in the monogen pulsar, this is a general properties of all the pulsars, or is just a peculiar property of these two sources that we have nearby? And the second question that I will discuss later on is the pulsar wind nebula are still a viable interpretation for the positron flux or not, since the two nearby ones cannot explain all the flux. So let's start with the first question. And before looking to the actual data, something that we need to understand is how the angular size of those objects is changing with respect to the energy. So we saw already that the extension of Geminga, for example, was larger at Fermi-LAT energies. And in particular, for this experiment, it's challenging to detect something that is more extended at let's say 10 degrees. Instead, for the very high energy experiment, such as S and OCK, we have the opposite problem that we have a few degrees instantaneous field of view. So it's challenging to detect anything that is more extended, for example. So in this plot, what we wanted to study was the evolution of this extension that we define as the angle that is containing the 68% of the gamma ray flux at a particular energy value as a function of the distance and of the age of the pulsars. And here you see the contours that are just computed for each point in this 2D plot. And they are green crossed. They are the position in which the pulsar from the catalogs are sitting. So you see here that at 10 GV, that is the plot in the left, a source that is 100 kilo years old should be far at least 0.9 kiloparsec in order to be detected with an extension smaller than 2 degrees. So that was kind of the region in which could be easy to detect a Fermi-LAT extension, while at 1 TeV, in principle, and by looking to diffusion coefficients that are similar to the Geminga values, most of the pulsars in the catalyst would be good targets for inverse Compton gamma ray ELOs, because they are basically all in this range between 0, let's say, and 5 degrees of extension. So what we did was to go into the catalogs and try to understand if we had already some observation of the sources in order to search for those ELOs. And in particular, we ranked all the pulsars that we have in the catalog according to the expected gamma ray flux at 10 GeV, discovering that the majority of the first ranks in this method were already sources that have been already detected by Oak and S experiments. So we decided to take the flux map that are available from the public S catalog and to extract the surface brightness above 1 TeV. So this is the flux as a function of the distance from the central position of the gamma ray peak, let's say. And here you see, for example, one example in which we extracted the data from this source. And then we fit this surface brightness with a model of the inverse Compton scattering emission coming from those electrons and positrons that have been accelerated. And for the majority of the case, we have a situation like this in which this diffusion profile is best at describing the gamma ray data with respect to the Gaussian profile, for example, that is normally used in order to, for example, compute what is the extension of those sources. So we repeated this exercise for a set of different sources, and we test if the diffusion around those sources was again inhibited. And the answer was yes. So in the majority of the sources that we analyzed, we found a low diffusion zone, and the value of this diffusion coefficient is similar to the value that was found for Geminga and Monogem. You see here those different points for different values of the age of the sources. And we found that this diffusion coefficient is systematically lower by two orders of magnitude with respect to the galactic mean value. We also report that there is not a clear trend with respect to the age. And the inverse Compton TeV ELOs, they show a typical size of about 35 parsec, as you can see here above 1 TeV. And what we are doing also, an analysis that is in progress, is to look also from a set of sources to the Fermi-LAT data in order to do the same exercise we did for Geminga and Monogem. So let's go to the final question. So what are the consequences of all this multi-messenger observation of those pulsars for the positron flux? So in principle, those two sources are not the only pulsar nebula in our galaxy. And in fact, in the past, by taking into account parameters for the production of cosmic rays around those two sources and the rest of the sources in the galaxy, so for example, an efficiency of few percent for the conversion of the pulsar spin down in electrons and positron pairs, and by taking into account all the distribution of pulsar in our galaxy, so both a smooth distribution or just the sources that we have in the catalog, it was demonstrated that actually you can fit the positron flux and the positron fraction. So now we want to understand what is the effect of this new evidence of the low diffusion bubbles around the pulsars. So we can still conclude that the positrons can be explained by the total contribution from galactic pulsar nebulae? The answer is yes. And in this last paper that I wanted to discuss in this seminar, we analyzed in particular what were the effects of this two-zone phenomenological model to describe the propagation around those sources. So by taking into account the fact that we analyzed a sample of pulsar nebula, 30 more or less in the previous analysis, we take those mean values as representative for the rest of the galactic pulsar, and we try to understand what is the cumulative emission from those sources if we take into account for all of them this two-zone diffusion model. So this is, for example, the effect on the total contribution from the pulsars in the catalog. For the value of the diffusion coefficient at the fixed value for this radio. of the bubble, and this is the effect instead of the radius of the bubble. So you see that the properties of this low diffusion zone, in particular, significantly affect the prediction for the positron flux at large energies, so where exactly we have the positron excess. So it's really fundamental to understand what are the properties of propagation around those sources in order to understand if we can explain or not the positron fluxes. But assuming that the values that we are finding in those initial analyses of the pulsar wind nebula Halo are representative for the rest of the galactic pulsars, what we concluded, and this is shown in those two plots, that both if you consider the pulsars that we have in the catalog, or if you consider the simulated galactic pulsars and you put them in spiral arms in order to model the distribution of distances around the Earth, the cumulative positron emission can still explain the positron excess. And I want to stress here that this is not a fit. So here I'm not fitting the data, but this is a prediction. So I'm just taking the total contribution for the different pulsars in the catalog or from the simulation. And this band is just the variation from different realizations of those simulations. And I'm reaching the level of positron data. Of course, more work needs to be done here in order to try to understand if we can, by varying the single parameters of the most important sources, we can still explain and fit better the positron flux. And this is some further work we would like to do in the future. So I'm going to my summaries. I hope that I explain to you why cosmic ray electrons and positron fluxes are a unique window on local sources of electrons and positrons, and how we can use multi-messenger analysis in order to reduce the uncertainties coming from the cosmic ray emission in supernova remnants and pulsar wind nebula. And then we discussed how we can use the radio data to constrain the electrons emission from nearby supernova remnants. And the take-home message here is that we need to understand more the release mechanism in order to predict more with more detail the emission from nearby sources. And then we discussed this very recent topic about the extended gamma ray halos around pulsar and pulsar wind nebula by looking to the detection of this halo also in Fermi-LAT data, and by looking to the constraint we can put on the interpretation of the positron flux, also using the Fermi-LAT data. And then in the last part, we saw how these TV halos that have been sometimes called in the literature are emerging as a general characteristic of the pulsars that we have in the galaxy, and new and promising source classes can be seen in the future experiments such as CTA. And the conclusion, as far as the analysis that we have done, is that the pulsar and their nebula remain the most promising candidate to expand the positron flux at the Earth, but now we have more insight into the cosmic ray production and emission mechanism in these sources. Thank you. I finished.
Thank you very much, Silvia. Very, yeah. It was very nice, your talk. I like it a lot.
Thank you.
So for all the viewers that are following us in YouTube, or you can start to write your questions in the chat in the YouTube system that we have in the stream, directly in the stream. And for those that are watching this video in the future with respect to the live transmission, remember that you can subscribe to the YouTube channel and also to follow us in Twitter or in following our WordPress page, in which we have the summary of all these webinars. So for the meanwhile, the people is writing question for Silvia. So okay. We can start the question round with the people here in the session.
Yeah.
So I don't know if there is somebody here of the two guys. Otherwise, I have, since this topic is one of the topics that I worked when I did the PhD. So it,
yeah.
I have many questions in the
Go ahead.
The other guys, but anyway, okay. Let's start with some question from YouTube. A good one. I'm gonna read it to you. On slide 14, if you can go to your slide 14, can you explain why the modeling with trapping and why there are E tot and gamma anticorrelated? It's from Philip Merch.
Yes, so you are asking why the total energy and the spectral index are
anti-correlated when you model in the traffic.
So this is connected probably to the escape mechanism that is modeled in this particular model. We are taking into account. So since there is this variation in spectral index, probably you have also variation in the normalization of the spectrum that you have at different in different slices, let's say, in the spectrum. This is my understanding.
Okay, so we're gonna, okay, let's wait that Philip will make any further comment.
Ah, sorry. If I understood he said, correctly, yeah.
Yeah, he said, sorry, in the escaped one, of course.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean.
Hope it was clear after this.
So let's see if we have more questions. Otherwise, I have one. In, for instance, when you model the change between the diffusion term between the inside and outside, I mean, the main part and the galactic medium one, in any other site that you were showing, you use this particular parametrization. What do you expect that the you have like a sudden change between one side to another, or you expect like some kind of smooth, I mean, the smooth transition?
This is this is an important point. So we are using the most simple phenomenological approximation in which there is a sharp cut, let's say, completely changed with respect to this RB. But in the literature that have been studied, and in particular in this reference, in this Profumo et al., they demonstrate that actually the way in which you change between the two different diffusion coefficients can have consequences on the form, then on the spectrum of the propagated cosmic rays. But for the moment, we don't have any clue on how this transition can be described. So we need to understand better, and we need to look to the gamma ray spectrum probably in this range once we will have the precision to look there in order to understand this. But of course, we don't expect that there is a sharp discontinuity, let's say.
Yeah. So, but also I was wondering, I mean, you effectively you have one diffusion term in one side and the other, but this diffusion term seems, we know, or more or less it's expected, that depends between the intensity of the magnetic field of the off or the amount of turbulence that the magnetic field exists. What do you think that could be the why it changing? Because of the magnetic field is dropping too fast, or it is?
So in general, it was kind of expected that in the region around the pulsar with nebula, the magnetic field and the turbulence is not the same as the rest of the interstellar medium. The evidence here is that this effect is actually extending way larger with respect to the boundary of the pulsar wind nebula that we see, for example, in X-rays. And there have been studies in the literature, and they are again here linked in this slide, in which they try to explain why there is this inhibited diffusion. So there can be some feedback of the cosmic rays that are confined there, or some different turbulence. But for the moment, there is not yet a unique understanding of this. This is something that is needed, some modeling that is needed in order to understand those observation, surely.
Okay, so, and okay, this is nice for the next, another question that I have that is, do you have any prospect, for instance, for future CTA that is gonna be able to help in this stretch of the gamma ray spectrum around
so
the-
So we produced, I have something in the backup. So we produced a very simple prediction of the number of possibly halo. If we consider that all the pulsars in the catalogs, they have this gamma ray halo, and this is the number that CTA can possibly detect as a function of this value of the efficiency. So you see that even for very small values of the efficiency, we expect to see a large number of those objects. So of course, the CTA can help in understanding if these sources are really a general characteristics of all the pulsars or if they are just characteristics of particular pulsars that we are seeing for the moment.
Yeah, that would be awesome. And and regarding also to the part, I mean, this is for the gamma rays, but relating with the radio signal associated to the pulsars, with the pulsar wind nebula, do you expect, for instance, ALMA or SKA can help in the quest? Because, or which are the, do you expect sources of data?
So of course, the detection of a, such a large extension in radio and X-ray is really challenging. So we started to understand this, and we realized that actually this extension is expected to be pretty large. But probably if you combine the observation in the same ROI, in the same region of interest, similarly to what is done in order to study the diffuse emission of the galaxy, for example, this can be possible, I think. But you need to provide really also a targeting analysis and method in order to understand this. And I'm not, honestly, I'm not an expert on X-ray and radio detectors and strategies of observation. So I will be happy to speak with some experts on that in order to see if it's possible.
Okay, so, and my last question, or at least in the slide, 32, I don't know if other people ask questions, because I don't know, it's not.
There are, okay.
Okay, so in your slide 32, because I like this slide, especially the graph are very impressive. And this wiggling of the flux is because that this was a kind of prediction either with the real data or with the simulated data. But this wiggling is there no matter the, in the case of the simulated galactic pulsars this sample has this kind of wiggling, or it's just
particular? No, this depends. This depends on the particular realization. So for example, you see here, right? This is a mean among 20 simulations. If you simulate more or less, you end up with the same band. And you see here these bands, but this is guided by very few sources. But there are also some realization in which you end up with a smooth profile. And you can see it here. So here, of course, we are considering all the sources with the same spectral index and with a distribution of efficiency. But what you can do, you can always play with the values of the particular sources that are contributing more and end up probably with a smooth. So this is something that we want to explore in the future. And it will be amazing to try to see the list of sources that are more, let's say, more dominant in the positron flux in gamma rays and X-rays in order to fix the parameters, right, of those sources, and then to see if they end up larger or lower with respect to the cosmic ray data. But in principle, I would say that the wiggles are a feature, but can be also avoided if you fit the contribution of different sources.
Yeah. So that, I mean, if you start, I mean, the sense that saying in a different way, if AMS, when it released new data or whatever in the future, it start to appear this kind of wiggling in the electron plus positron flux or on the electron. So it could be a good indication that these type of sources would be the right
one. Yeah. Then of course you see on the plot on the right that the uncertainties in the prediction are for the moment larger with respect to the uncertainties in the data. So we need to be careful also in interpreting those. So we can always find a model that is exactly fit in order to explain those features, but in principle the theoretical uncertainties are larger here.
So, okay, but the other point is, I mean, this is except of the question. The many people, when they are talking about in case of dark matter annihilation producing electron, that you cannot generate or you can generate a strong sharp cut in the flux. But looking your your plot in the left side, it seems that your flux cannot be sharply going down or something like that.
Yeah, this is connected, as you see here, both to the properties of this diffusion, I think, but also to the properties of the sources that contribute exactly in this range in which you see the cutoff. Because imagine that the sources that are in this region, they have a smaller efficiency or a different cutoff, then you can probably recover this. And then we are not yet sure what will happen at the multi-TV. So one prediction of this modeling, and in particular of the continuous emission scenario, is that at some point you will reach some flattening, let's say, from the continuous injection. And this can be tested with future data, of course. But for the moment, we have this this evidence for a sharp cutoff that can be continually or can be just one cutoff from one source, and then you can have other contribution. Let's see what data will say to us.
OK. So those were my questions. Let's see if the it seems that in YouTube there are no more questions. Okay. So I don't know the rest of the guys here in the audience if they want to ask. Otherwise, we can. There is a chat. Let's see. Okay. So if there are no more questions, we can thank Silvia again. It was a pleasure to have her here in the Law of Physics with this nice talk. And for the rest of the audience, you can tune up for the next webinar that in principle could be in the next 2 weeks. So especially in this period that we have to stay at home. So this is a good way to spread science and to keep the activities. So for all the people that is following us and everything, stay safe, stay at home, and see you in the next opportunity.
Thank you.